محمد يا رب العالمين اللهم صل على محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم. And I close my eyes and I'm floating. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuhu. I welcome you to another episode of our series Sirat al-Rasul, Lessons and Morals, where we discuss the life and times, the teaching and message, the morals and manners of our Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. We were discussing the aftermath of the Battle of Badr, the very first battle that occurred between the Muslims and the pagans, the Muslims of Medina and the Quraysh of Mecca. And these were the first time in the history of Islam that prisoners of war were taken. And so the Prophet ﷺ surveyed these 70 people, and they were all tied up, as they would tie up prisoners at the time, and they were all tied up and bound. And the Prophet ﷺ said a very cryptic remark. And he said, if Mut'im ibn Adi had been alive, and he asked me to hand over these filthy people to him, I would have handed him over without asking any questions. What is this, and who is Mut'im ibn Adi, and why is he saying this? Mut'im ibn Adi is that personality who we can say, after Abu Talib, the real uncle of the Prophet ﷺ, the number one supporter from amongst the non-Muslims was Mut'im ibn Adi. The number one helper of the Prophet ﷺ during his 13 years in Mecca had been, of course, his uncle, but then after him had been Mut'im ibn Adi, from amongst the non-Muslims. From amongst the Muslims, of course, that is a separate story. Mut'im ibn Adi was a noble person. Even though he never embraced Islam, he did his utmost to help the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Mut'im ibn Adi is that person who, when the Quraysh boycotted the Banu Hashim, and they sent them into exile, into a valley, Mut'im ibn Adi, even though he's not from the Banu Hashim, he would go in the middle of the night and take a camel and load it with food and with water and with grain and with dates, and he would send it into that valley so that the Muslims could eat of this camel and eat of all that is on it for many, many months to come. Mut'im ibn Adi would do this, and he would not expect anything back from the Muslims. Mut'im ibn Adi was that person who, when the treaty was enacted to boycott the Banu Hashim, Mut'im ibn Adi was one of the main people who stood up against that treaty from amongst the non-Muslims, and he did his best to make sure that the Banu Hashim were allowed admittance back into the Quraysh. And Mut'im ibn Adi had just recently died. He had died before the Battle of Badr. He did not witness the Battle of Badr. And so the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, in a symbolic way, he basically gave him that respect. He honored him by saying in public, even though Mut'im is dead, he just said in public, if Mut'im had been alive and he asked me to hand over these 70 people without any questions, I would have handed him over. In other words, to show respect to Mut'im. And this shows it, and I've said this over and over again, and it is a constant theme of our seerah, that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam appreciated and recognized the help that non-Muslims gave him. And it is very possible for a person to be of another religion and yet he has good manners and good akhlaq, and he's a noble person, even if he has a different theology and he has a different fate in the hereafter. In this world, he is to be shown respect and he is to be honored. And that is exactly what the Prophet ﷺ did to Mut'im, so much so that he symbolically, if you like, it's a symbolic medal. This is what we do. We award people medals after they die. We award them posthumously. Sometimes we award to them various recognitions. This is what the Prophet ﷺ did when he praised Mut'im ibn Adi after his death. And the question then arose, what is to be done with these 70 prisoners of war? This is the first time that the Muslims have taken captives. And these people are not ordinary people. They are not just people walking on the street or walking between the places. These are the people a few hours before they had swords in their hands wanting to kill the Muslims. A few hours before they were burning with rage and animosity, and now they are tied up and bound in front of the Muslims. These were the people who marched from Mecca all the way to Badr out of nothing but spite and hatred against Islam and the worship of Allah. Each and every one of them has a history. Each and every one of them has a past. Each and every one of them has done crimes against humanity and crimes against the Muslims and has aided and abetted in expelling and torturing the Muslims and causing them to be in the situation they are in. So, should they take into account all of these crimes and their state and therefore charge them with treason and murder and then give the punishment of execution? Or should they be generous and free them with a ransom? What should be the option? Should they be executed because of their crimes, or should they be allowed to walk free with a ransom? This was the question that was in the minds of the Muslims, and it was in fact the question that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam asked the closest of his companions. And as we said over and over again, an exemplary characteristic of our Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam is the fact that he would always seek the counsel and take the advice of those closest to him. And in matters afflicting the entire ummah, he would get the advice of the entire ummah, such as the Battle of Badr. And in matters that were a little bit more technical and precise, he would get the advice of those close to him, such as the prisoners of war at Badr. He didn't ask all the companions what they thought, rather he asked those closest to him. And this shows us that in Islam there is this concept of a consultative body, of a parliament if you like, of a group of people whose advice should be sought and should be followed. And so the Prophet ﷺ asked his closest companions, and Abu Bakr represented one camp and Umar represented another. The two of them differed amongst themselves. As for Abu Bakr, then Abu Bakr's nature, as you all know, was towards the softer side and towards the gentle side. And there is a time and a place for the softer and gentle nature. And Abu Bakr said, O Messenger of Allah, they are our uncles and they are our cousins and they are the children of our uncles. In other words, he's saying they are our kith and kin, our flesh and blood. Why don't we just let them go and ransom them? Let them go and let them pay a ransom and they can go back to Mecca. And as for Umar ibn al-Khattab, he said, O Messenger of Allah, these are the leaders of kufr. They have done what they have done and they have sought to kill us and they have done so much against us. How can we let them go? We should make them examples for the rest of the people out there. Let them know that they are not supposed to oppose Islam and persecute Muslims for no reason. Let us make examples of them and let us execute them. In fact, Umar ibn al-Khattab said, in fact, why don't each and every one of us take charge of the execution of those closest to us so that nobody from outside can claim that this was motivated by any other reason. In other words, we don't want to revive the pagan tendencies of tribalism. We don't want a non-Qurashi to kill a Qurashi, otherwise the Quraysh will then get angry at the tribe of the killer. Rather, Umar ibn al-Khattab said, as an example, I will take charge of those closest to me in the prisoners of war, and I will be responsible for their execution. Now, the Prophet ﷺ was faced with two choices. The one of them was the merciful choice of Abu Bakr, and the other was the justice, if you like, of Umar. And you know, there's a time and a place for both of these emotions. At times you should be strict, at times you should be gentle. The perfection of our religion, brothers and sisters, the perfection of our religion is that it teaches us the general rule of mercy, but it also tells us that there are times to be strict, because this is the way the world operates. You see, there are religions out there, they teach their followers to turn the other cheek and to always be merciful. Those people who teach this can never practice it. Those people who teach this doctrine can never ever practice it, because it is an impractical philosophy. You cannot always turn the other cheek or else you will be taken advantage of. You cannot always be merciful or else you will get nowhere in life and everybody will always humiliate you and take advantage of you. Rather, there must be a time and a place where justice is shown and sternness is demonstrated. So there's a time for mercy and gentleness and a time for strictness and justice. Which of these two times was appropriate for the prisoners of war of Badr? This is what the Prophet ﷺ was asking. And it's a difficult question. And so in the end, the Prophet ﷺ leaned towards the side of Abu Bakr. And he decided to forgive. And he decided to let go. And he decided to let them go back to Mecca for a ransom. However, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed in the Quran verses, which are recited to this day. And there are verses found in the Quran. And as we said many times, Surah Al-Anfal is the main verse and the main surah that was revealed for the Battle of Badr. And Allah says in Surah Al-Anfal, وَمَا كَانَ لِنَبِيٍّ أَن يَكُونَ لَهُ أَسْرَى حَتَّى يُثْخِنَ فِي الْأَرْضِ. It is not appropriate, it is not befitting that any Prophet of Allah take prisoners of war until he establishes his authority in the land. You shouldn't take prisoners until you have power. And so people can know that your mercy was based upon power and not mercy based upon weakness. Allah says, تُرِيدُونَ عَرَضَ الدُّنْيَا وَاللَّهُ يُرِيدُ الْآخِرَةِ. Some of you wanted the material blessings of this world, but Allah is wanting the hereafter for you. Some people, of those who wanted to follow Abu Bakr's opinion, remember there's two camps, some of the companions who agreed with Abu Bakr, their motivation was the ransom. They wanted money for these prisoners. And Allah is saying, you wanted the money, Allah wants the hereafter for you. Allah is not thinking the way that you are thinking. Allah Azza wa Jalla's wisdom, Allah's divine wisdom is infinitely more than your wisdom. And so Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, you want this world and I want the hereafter. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, were it not for the fact that the decree has already come, it might be that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala would have punished you for what you have done. So when this was revealed, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam became very distressed that he had chosen the wrong opinion. And he began to cry. And Abu Bakr cried with him. And Umar passed by the two of them. And he said, what is making the two of you cry? And so he was told a relation of these verses, and he too began to cry with them, seeing the anguish of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam. We need to take a short break now. Soon as we come back, we will continue talking about the story of the prisoners of the Battle of Badr. Stay with us. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah. Welcome back. We were discussing the story of the prisoners of war and what the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam did with them. And we had said that faced between the two choices of mercy and leniency, and between justice and execution, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam had chosen that of mercy. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed in the Quran that mercy should have been shown after you had established authority. Otherwise, people don't know why you are being merciful. And this shows us, this incident is a very, very profound incident in that it shows us the Prophet of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, sometimes he acted based upon what he thought was the best. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala then, and it was not the best, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala then corrected him. And there are a number of such corrections in the Quran. The point being the Prophet of Allah doesn't mean that he's infallible, that he's divine. Rather, it means if he makes a mistake, Allah will correct him. This is what it means. Sometimes he made something that later on the Quran comes and corrects him and reprimands him. And this is the most significant example of this, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala very clearly says that this should not have been done, but now you can go ahead and do it. This should not have been done, but now that you have agreed to do this, then let it be. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala allowed the ransoming of the prisoners, even though he said this was not the correct decision to have been done. And the reason why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala criticized this is in the Quran. And Allah says, until the Prophet establishes authority in the land. That's when the Muslims are weak. And then you forgive. This is an indication of your weakness. Whereas if they had been executed, then this would have sent fear into the hearts of the enemy. And it would have given authority and supremacy to the Islamic Republic. Also, this is the first major battle. And there were at least 8 or 9 battles to follow. Many of those who were freed went back to fight in the other battles, and they came back to kill other Muslims. Many of those who were freed, they went back to Mecca, and they fought in Uhud, and they fought in Khandaq, and they fought in Ahzab, and they fought in so many other battles, and this led to the death of a number of Muslims. And so, that was not the time to free, unlike the conquest of Mecca. In the conquest of Mecca, when the Prophet ﷺ conquered Mecca, it was perfection to free everybody. It was perfection to set everyone free without even a ransom. No ransom was given in the conquest of Mecca. But now is not the time and place. Allah is saying the time and place will come. Now it wasn't it, but you've decided it. Then so be it. Also, Umar ibn Khattab alluded to another wisdom. And that is that loyalty should be shown ultimately to Islam and to the bonds of faith. And he said that he would be willing to take charge of the execution of his own kith and kin, so that that could be shown that ultimate loyalty belongs to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and no bond is stronger than the bond that man has with God. No blood relationship can come between that. In any case, this was the ruling for the Battle of Badr, and of course, later on, once Islam was established, and throughout Islamic history, the ruling of the prisoners of war has always been that it is up to the Khalifa. Remember, this is the first time it's happening. So Allah is saying, you should have been strict then. As for after this time, throughout our history, we've always had the fact that when the prisoners are captured, it is up to the caliph, it is up to the ruler, if he wishes to take them as slaves, if he wishes to free them without a ransom, if he wishes to free them with a ransom, all of this can be decided by the khalifa. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave permission to sell the captives for a ransom. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam sent back the news of the victory to Medina. Now you can imagine the people in Medina are waiting anxiously to find out what is happening. They don't know the news. And so the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam sends back Zayd ibn Haritha. And he said, use my camel. So Zayd ibn Haritha rode on the camel of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And by the way, the camel's name was Al-Qaswa. Even the name of the camel of the Prophet ﷺ is recorded in the books of history. It is Al-Qaswa. And Zayd was so excited and so eager that he's rushed back on the camel. And as soon as he came to the outskirts of Medina, he began screaming and he began shouting, O people of Medina, we have won. O people of Medina, Utba ibn Rabi'ah has been killed. Shayba ibn Rabi'ah has been killed. Umayyah ibn Khalaf has been killed. Abu Jahl has been killed. Suhayd ibn Amr has been taken as a captive. And he mentioned each and every leader of the Quraysh. The beautiful thing about the Battle of Badr is that not a single leader of the Quraysh remained alive, except that either they killed him or they took him a captive. No one participated in Badr of significance except that either he was killed at the hands of the Muslims or he was taken captive. And so Zayd ibn Haritha is rushing through and he's screaming to the people. And the people cannot believe, this cannot be true. This cannot be true. You're telling me that every single leader of the Quraysh has been killed, that either they've been killed or taken captive. You're telling me we have hardly had any loss. And Zayd ibn Haritha's own son, Usama ibn Zayd, he said, I could not believe my own father. I couldn't believe my own father that this could be true until I saw with my own eyes the prisoners of war being dragged and led into Medina. In other words, the victory was so good that nobody believed it. And of course here, the hypocrites, they began an evil rumor. As soon as they saw Zayd ibn Haritha and he began to shout out the good news, they said, definitely the Muslims have suffered such a resounding defeat that Zayd has gone mad. Can you not see that he's riding the camel of the Prophet ﷺ? Something must have happened to him, and Zayd has gone mad, and he's gone delirious, and that's why he is screaming these unbelievably good news, because it cannot possibly have occurred. And of course, it was only a matter of time, only a matter of half a day, before the actual army returned, and lo and behold, everybody is safe and sound. The Muslims come back, hardly touched, unscathed. And they're bringing with them 70 prisoners of war of the leaders of the Quraysh. And they have already killed 70 of their other leaders. And of course, it was only a matter of time before this evil rumor was quelled and squashed. But this shows us that this is the way of the people full of hate and spite. Even at the best of times, when the news was so good to be true, they had to do something. They had to say something. They had to turn and make a story into it. People whose hearts is full of disease, no matter what you show them, their disease will remain in their hearts. You cannot guide everybody. And even in this Battle of Badr, there were people who wanted to make a story out of it. In any case, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam returned back to Medina with these 70 captives. And they were all brought into the masjid. And they were all put in the masjid of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Now the question arose, what to do with them? Who will take care of them? They have to be fed. They have to be given some free area that they can walk around and they can sit in. They have to be monitored and guarded. And there were no jails in all of Arabia. The concept of a jail is not something that existed at the time of the Prophet ﷺ or even the early Khulafa. There was no such thing as a house where you lock people up. That was unheard of. So what should be done with these 70 captives of war? Here the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, let every single person who captured somebody, take him to his house and feed him with his food and be generous to him until the ransom money comes. Let every single person take the captive back to his home. And the Prophet himself took the leader, the single most significant and noble person, and that was Suhayd ibn Amr, and he put him in his own house. Now I want you to think about this. I want you to think about this. Where in the history of humanity has a prisoner of war been taken to the house of the captor and fed the same food as the captor, So much so that the prisoner of war is housed in the house of the leader himself, and that is the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. Suhail ibn Amr is put in the house of the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam in his own living room. You tell me, what instance, what parallel do we have in the history of mankind? Here we have our history in front of us. Never before have we seen such magnanimity, such generosity. This is what you call human rights, my dear brothers and sisters. This is what you call the Islamic standard. Yes, they fought us in the battle. Now Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has allowed us to ransom them. Therefore, we must treat them with the utmost kindness. So much so that when the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam told the Sahaba to treat them kindly, the Ansar took them back home and they fed them better food than themselves. So much so that one of the prisoners himself narrates that when I was eating with the Ansar, they would put the meat and the bread on my side of the plate and they would take the rest. And out of embarrassment, I was embarrassed, I'm the prisoner, I would put the meat back, I would put the bread back on their side, but they would take it again and put it in front of me forcefully, that you must eat of this. This is a prisoner of war, and he was fed better food than the Ansar. Why? One word from the mouths of the beloved of the Prophet ﷺ. One word, treat them kindly. That's all he needed to say. And these prisoners were then treated better than the people treated themselves. Such unparalleled treatment of the prisoners. And this, I ask you to compare such treatment with the treatment that is meted out in our times to those countries that are claiming to champion democracy and to be leaders of human rights. They house people in cages, worse than cages for dogs and animals. They put people and lock them up without trial, without anything. And they're there for years and years and nothing can be done. And these are people who are claiming to champion human rights and to be leaders of the world, freedom and democracy. Here is our Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And when he tells one word, treat them nicely. There is no United Nations Charter. There is no Universal Declaration of Human Rights. There is the Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And he has said one word, treat them nicely. And they are treated better than the people treat themselves. So much so that Suhail ibn Amr is housed in the very house of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. As we said, this is the true Islamic and humane treatment that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam demonstrated in word and action, in spirit and in actual practice. And these are the exemplary standards that our religion sets. Now, these prisoners of war, as we said that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam announced they should be ransomed. Therefore, the news was sent back to Mecca with the list and the names of all of these prisoners of war. And it was requested that the families and the tribes of each one of these people send in ransom so that they could be freed. And as a further sign of mercy, each and every prisoner was assigned a price that was affordable to that prisoner. This is also something amazing. Not every prisoner had to pay the same amount. Those who were rich were given a heftier fine, a much higher price. And those who were poor, they were given a much lower price. And where again in the history of humanity is this found? Always a prisoner is given a certain value. But in Islam, they took into account their financial status. They took into account somebody is rich and somebody is poor. And so bit by bit, slowly but surely, the money began to trickle back into Medina and people came to ransom off each and every one of their relatives, some of them for high prices, some of them for lower prices. And there are a number of stories that need to be mentioned along with this ransoming. We've come to the conclusion of today's episode. Inshallah ta'ala, when we come back again next time, we'll continue from where we left off. Until next time, assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Allahumma salli ala Muhammad ya rabb alalamin. Allahumma salli ala Muhammad sallallahu